As a child in the 1960s, Jacqueline Woodson moved with her family from Greenville, South Carolina, to Brooklyn in New York City. Her memoir, Brown Girl Dreaming, tells of her childhood experiences growing up in both places. In a memoir, an author recalls important events in his or her life. Brown Girl Dreaming is unique as a memoir because it is written in verse or as poetry. About the author, Jacqueline Woodson, born 1964, was born in Columbus, Ohio. She recalls being happiest as a child when she was writing. I wrote on paper bags and my shoes and denim binders. A 2008 Newbery Honor winner, Woodson believes that writers need to be honest and to listen to the voices of young people. From Brown Girl Dreaming by Jacqueline Woodson. Brooklyn rain. The rain here is different than the way it rains in Greenville. No sweet smell of honeysuckle. No soft squish of pine. No slip and slide through grass. Just Mama saying, "Stay inside today. It's raining." And me at the window.
Nothing to do but watch the gray sidewalk grow darker.
Watch the drops slide down the glass pane. Watch people below me move fast, heads bent. Already there are stories in my head. Already color and sound and words. Already I'm drawing circles on the grass, humming myself someplace far away from here. Down south, there was always someplace else to go. You could step out into the rain and Grandma would let you lift your head and stick out your tongue. Be happy. Down south already feels like a long time ago, but the stories in my head take me back there. Set me down in Daddy's garden where the sun is always shining. Another way. While our friends are watching TV or playing outside, we are in our house, knowing that begging our mother to turn the television on is useless. Begging her for 10 minutes outside will only mean her saying no. Saying, "You can run wild with your friends anytime. Today, I want you to find another way to play." And then one day, my mother comes home with two shopping bags filled with board games, Monopoly, checkers, chess, Ants in the Pants, Sorry, Trouble. Just about every game we've ever seen in the commercials between our Saturday morning cartoons. So many games, we don't know where to begin playing. So we let Roman choose. And he chooses Trouble because he likes the sound the die makes when it pops inside its plastic bubble. And for days and days, it is Christmas in November. Games to play when our homework is done, Monopoly money to count, and checkers to slam down on boards, Ants to flip into blue plastic pants, chess pieces to practice moving until we understand their power. And when we don't, Roman and I argue that there's another way to play called our way. But Hope and Dell tell us that we're too immature to even begin to understand, then bend over the chessboard in silence, each becoming the next chess champ of the house, depending on the day and the way the game is played. Sometimes, Roman and I leave Hope and Dell alone to go to another corner of the room and become what the others call us, the two youngest, playing games we know the rules to, tic-tac-toe and checkers, hangman and connect the dots. But mostly, we lean over their shoulders as quietly as we can, watching, waiting, wanting to understand how to play another way. Gifted. Everyone knows my sister is brilliant. The letters come home folded neatly inside official-looking envelopes that my sister proudly hands over to my mother. Adela has achieved. Adela has excelled at. Adela has been recommended to. Adela's outstanding performance in. She is gifted, we are told, and I imagine presents surrounding her. I am not gifted. When I read, the words twist, twirl across the page. When they settle, it is too late. The class has already moved on. I want to catch words one day. I want to hold them, then blow gently. Watch them float right out of my hands. Sometimes. There is only one other house on our block where a father doesn't live. When somebody asks why, the boy says, "He died." The girl looks off down the block, her thumb slowly rising to her mouth. The boy says, "I was a baby." Says she doesn't remember him and points to his silent sister. Sometimes I lie about my father. "He died," I say, "in a car wreck, or he fell off a roof, or maybe he's coming soon. Next week, and next week, and next week." But if my sister's nearby, she shakes her head, says she's making up stories again, says We don't have a father anymore, says. Our grandfather's our father now, says. Sometimes that's the way things happen. Uncle Robert. Uncle Robert has moved to New York City. I hear him taking the stairs two at a time, and then he is at our door, knocking loud until our mother opens it, curlers in her hair, robe pulled closed, whispering, "It's almost midnight. Don't you wake my children." But we're already awake, all four of us, smiling and jumping around my uncle. "What'd you bring me?" Our mama shushes us, says, "It's too late for presents and the like, but we want presents and the like." And she, too, is smiling now, happy to see her baby brother who lives all the way over in Far Rockaway, where the ocean is right there if you look out your window. Robert opens his hand to reveal a pair of silver earrings, says to my sister, "This is a gift for how smart you are." I want to be smart like Dell. I want someone to hand me silver and gold just because my brain clicks into thinking whenever it needs to, but I'm not smart like Dell. So I watch her press the silver moons into her ears. I say, "I know a girl 10 times smarter than her. She gets diamonds every time she gets 100 on a test." And Robert looks at me, his dark eyes smiling, asks, "Is that something you made up or something real?" In my own head, it's real as anything. In my head, all kinds of people are doing all kinds of things. I want to tell him this, that the world we're living in right here in Brownsville isn't the only place. But now my brothers are asking, "What'd you bring me?" And my uncle is pulling gifts from his pockets, from his leather briefcase, from inside his socks. He hands my mother a record, a small 45, James Brown, who none of us like because he screams when he sings. But my mother puts it on the record player, turned way down low, and then even us kids are dancing around. Robert's showing us the steps he learned at the Far Rockaway parties. His feet are magic. And we all try to slide across the floor like he does, our own feet again and again betraying us. "Teach us, Robert," we keep saying. "Teach us." Wishes. When he takes us to the park, Uncle Robert tells us, "If you catch a dandelion puff, you can make a wish. Anything you want will come true," he says, as we chase the feathery wishes around swings, beneath sliding boards, until we can hold them in our hands, close our eyes tight, whisper our dream, then set it floating out into the universe, hoping our uncle is telling the truth, hoping each thing we wish for will one day come true. Believing. The stories start like this. "Jack and Jill went up a hill," my uncle sings. "I went up a hill yesterday," I say. "What hill?" "In the park." "What park?" "Halsey Park." "Who was with you?"
"Nobody."
"But you're not allowed to go to the park without anyone."
"I just did."
"Maybe you dreamed it," my uncle says. "No, I really went." And my uncle likes the stories I'm making up. Along came a spider and sat down beside her.
"I got bit by a spider," I say.
"When?"
"The other day."
"Where?"
"Right on my foot."
"Show us."
"It's gone now."
But my mother accuses me of lying. "If you lie," she says, "one day you'll steal."
"I won't steal."
It's hard to understand how one leads to the other, how stories could ever make us criminals. It's hard to understand the way my brain works, so different from everybody around me, how each new story I'm told becomes a thing that happens in some other way to me. "Keep making up stories," my uncle says.
"You're lying," my mother says.
Maybe the truth is somewhere in between all that I'm told and memory.